Welcome to the last session for today. And we have Ali, Istalifi, is a specialist in Central Asian textiles. He is originally from Afghanistan, but has been living in London most of his life. For three generations, his family has been dealing in fine Central Asian textiles. During the 70s, his father, one of the main sources of fine textiles, helping build some of the best collections in the world. Ali has an extraordinary collection himself and recently wrote the catalogue of an Ikat exhibition in Museum of Arts, Birmingham. I have great pleasure in introducing and requesting Ali to come to the stage and give us his presentation.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for coming today and being the last speaker. There's a lot of pressure on me to make this interesting, so none of you fall asleep or leave. I will try. So I'm going to talk to you about Central Asian Ikat. And there's a lot that has been said about Central Asian Ikat generally. Some of the best museum exhibitions has happened on it. Books have been written on it. And the reason for it is, when you see these two pieces, the dazzling designs is what's really just captured the imagination of everyone. But what I'm going to try to do is talk about something slightly different than simply saying how they were woven. I will give you a little bit of history, but I want to talk about how to define them and how to read their designs. Because the designs are so rich and so powerful, they often connect to all of us. I mean, anyone who sees it, even those who are not familiar with it, somehow get mesmerized. But what is the reason behind it? Oh boy, here we go. So brief history. This is the bit I have to condense, because I can talk about this for a symposium on my own. It's a big, big tradition, but I'll try to do this for science sake. So Central Asia produce some of the most beautiful and sophisticated textiles in history. They had a very rich tradition of silk embroideries, silk fabrics, weaving, jewelry, everything you could imagine they made, especially as their silks were fantastic. But of all their textiles, the dazzling silk Ikat fabrics were some of the most coveted, as you can see by those pictures. And these fabrics, these Ikat fabrics, were often woven in looms that were about 30 centimeters to 45 centimeters wide, and probably anywhere between 6 to 10 to 20 meters long. And then they will tailor these into two types of textiles. One was garments, like robes, dresses, trousers, and hats, as you see there in those pictures. And this was for men, for women, for boys, and for girls. And the other things they made was wall hangings and decorations for their home. Just imagine a society where people were dressed like this. I don't think depression existed then. And what's more interesting is that this was the steppes where these, when we talk about Central Asia, what do we really mean by Central Asia? I mean, these were desert oases, you know? And to create this kind of color, this kind of vibrance, this kind of designs, they must have had some amazing imagination. And these are some of the Ikats, just to give you an idea of some of the Ikats that they made. And you see the designs are so bold. They have these crazy archaic motifs. They're enigmatic. You know, you could somehow make sense of them, but they're so crazy. And the colors, which is really the merit of these textiles, were vibrant. They were jumping at you. You know, they were not, the Central Asian people were not about subtlety. They were not there. I mean, if you think about it, like rap stars now, it's bling, this is bling. They wanted to show, they wanted to make a statement, you know, the look at us. In fact, if you think about it, some of the cities like Bukhara, Samarkand, these cities with these architectures in the middle of the desert, they really wanted to say, look at us, we're here. And there was a specific reason for that. So, golden era of Central Asian Ikat. It's been assumed that people in Central Asia have been making Ikats for centuries. It's interesting that one of the oldest Ikats that was ever discovered, that is assumed to be Central Asian, was really not discovered in Central Asia, but in Japan, in Horyoji Temple in Nara, I think. And it was a little fragment. It's assumed that it got itself to Japan around 500 to 600 AD. And people assumed, they concluded this is Central Asian just simply because they resembled the weaving techniques of the later Ikats, and as well as through elimination that they couldn't be anything else. This suggests that they've been making this for about at least since 6th century. But saying that, there's not a lot of examples that we have discovered or excavated that show anything outside of prior to 19th century. So most Ikats, especially the antiques ones that you see today, date between early 19th century and about first quarter of 20th century, maybe a little bit back and forth, it's not exact science. Yeah. And this 100-year period was the golden era of Ikat production. It somehow exploded. This is the bit I have to keep it concise, because this is very deep. Okay. So to understand really what caused this boom, you have to really need to understand the nature of this region. You know, we say Central Asia, everywhere else we pick a particular country to look for Central Asia. This is a huge land, just look at the map, that's huge. A lot of countries are there. First thing, they were the heart of the Silk Route. For those of you who probably live in the moon, the Silk Route is this ancient trade route that linked China and the Mediterranean Sea. And in this route, merchants would take silks from east to west and west to east. They would take spices, precious metals, ideas, and probably, in my opinion, one of the most important trade routes in the history of mankind. I'm sure the opinion of many more. But this map that we see here, apparently from CIA website, it was done in 1992. This kind of shows you the borders. You see countries like Turkmenistan, Uzbekistan, Kazakhstan, Tajikistan. Afghanistan kind of fits in Central Asia, or at least I like it to be. it's the center of Central Asia, but I'll get into that in a bit. So this map that we see, these borders, were really created by the Soviets after the Bolshevik Revolution in around 1920s. And this is very relevant because before this, these maps were just, they decided, let's cut this land in this crazy borders that doesn't make sense, because some Tajiks live in Uzbekistan and some Uzbeks live in Kyrgyzstan. And some, the complex ethnic makeup of this region is simplified for a particular political agenda. And this has a relevance on the Ikats and the production. Because the idea was that if you divide these ethnic groups, none of them could rise against the Soviet agenda. But during 19th century, this map was obsolete. It was basically, the land was a series of desert oasis towns and cities that were independent kingdoms. And the large of these were cities like Bukhara, Samarkand, Khiva, Shahr-e Sabz, and Khokand, and a few others. But these major ones were really the intersecting cities in this trade route. So when merchants came to Bukhara, they would go north, they would go south, they would go east, they would go west. Of course, to try to understand it in the 21st century kind of geography, imagine Bukhara was a bit like Dubai. The biggest skyscrapers and the biggest everything just attract merchants to come there and trade through them. So they were deliberately, all these architectures were deliberately built there, not just in 19th century, but historically, to attract people to come in there. Because of the fact that they were in the intersecting points and important trade hubs, they became very rich, these cities. Historically, they became rich, but in the 19th century, it was a real economic boom. And the economic boom was really when people had money, they wanted to have money, right? And what is more luxurious on the Silk Route than silk? So there was a real desire and demand for silk garments, silk embroidery, silk everything. In fact, even the animals, they dressed them in silks, because they could, initially, the city of Bukhara, Samarkand, and Khokand, were the main centers of Ikat production. A lot of workshops developed there. The Bukhara Ikats in particular were the finest, the top. And the second half of the 19th century, an area called Ferhana Valley became the next major center of Ikat production. By about mid-19th century, or actually the third quarter of the 19th century, Ferhana Valley surpassed Bukhara as the main center of Ikat production. And the reason was for it was quite simple. Ferhana Valley's designs were relatively, slightly less extravagant as Bukhara. And for the Bukhara Ikats to produce these fabulous designs took more time, so workshops weren't really creating the cash flow that they needed in order to sustain. So they were making less beautiful things, but it was not giving them enough money to pay their workers. But for Ferhana Valley, you made slightly simpler designs, and because of that, economies of scale set in. So, and the tradition around early 1900s slowed down, because initially Russia was trying to exert its influence in Central Asia and systematically taking these different towns, these different kingdoms. A lot of them submitted, like Khiva. They said, look guys, we'll accept you guys as our rulers, but just don't destroy us. And this instability in the region really was the reason why the economy wasn't doing as well. And of course, once the Bolshevik Revolution happened, and the Soviets took over the region, as you know, they just divided it, took everyone to go to cotton fields and work there, and this tradition really died. And so Ikats really stopped, not abruptly, but kind of abrupt enough, around 1930s. They made some very bad quality types, and we'll get into that in a second. But so really the period for Central Asian Ikat was the golden era, was early 19th century, first quarter of 20th century. Now, look at this picture. This is a picture I got from the Library of Congress in Samarkand during the 19th century. And you see these fabulous ikats that you see, and they're very expensive. I mean, in all kinds of big stuff going on in there. But you see everybody's dressed up like that, always they are. And these ikats were really not just garments, they're not just because they want to be flashy, they're always also a symbol of status. Certain groups could only wear certain types. For example, the Jewish community of Central Asia were limited to wearing just yellow color, which was slightly different than a typical ikat. It was called Khalili ikat. And the more colors and the more elaborate designs it had, they were often called haftran, which means seven colors. And they were the most complex ones to weave. So therefore, they would be very expensive, and only that aristocrats and the noble families could wear. I'm not going to give you guys a long, boring speech about how these ikats were woven, because I don't think any of us are going to go out there and start fishing one of these out because it's impossible. But these pictures just give you an idea. Ikats were not the work of an individual. No one individual knew all the process of production. They're rather collective. A group of technicians and artists, but of course, the more experienced masters would often focus on the most complex processes. And the less experienced would be like stringing out a weft, you know, because it was easy. Silk was in every household. And the story of the silk is quite funny, but my mother's in the audience, so I don't know if I should say. Basically, every woman apparently had little pouches, and they would have these the silk larvae stitched on these pouches. And they would put it underneath the garment on their skin. And the idea was that the warmth of the woman's body really where all these beautiful things began. So, you know, it feeds our Orientalist mindsets. So anyway, they excavated the silk. As you see, they put it in the cocoons in boiling water and then extracted it. They put it on these looms, make warps. And then the guy in the middle is the design maker, which was one of the most important people. And this is the bit that the second half of the talk. He would draw these crazy designs on them, and then they would go through the tie-dye process, which is so complex, I'm not going to get into it. And the dyeing was another school of people who did it, often the dyes of Central Asian ikats is attributed to the Central Asian Jewish community. It's true, but it's not the full truth. Dyeing, as important as it is to these beautiful fabrics, at core, it was a very messy work. I mean, the dyes always had dirty hands and it was smelly, and nobody really wanted to do it, especially the Central Asian Muslim community. But cleansing is part of the prayer ritual. It's very important. So, unfortunately, being on the fringe of the community, the Jewish community, were left with no choices to take jobs that they could get. And the dyes are very complex. Most of the dyes they made it locally. But except for indigo, which was brought from India, again showing this connection between silk route, indigo was a dye exclusively dealt with by the Jewish merchants. It first made it from India to Afghanistan in Herat, and then by the Khalidis, they call it, the Jewish communities. And then from Herat, the foreign Jews would bring it to Bukhara. And indigo is an important part of the designs and the colors. So how to identify Central Asian ikats? A friend of mine, a very knowledgeable rug scholar from Germany, she told me something very fascinating, and if I'm wrong, please forgive me. But Central Asian ikat is one of the few ikat types that had, although they were all wall-faced, meaning the designs on the wall, it was one of the few ikat types that had different techniques, different styles. Not technique of weaving per se, but how they use the wefts, what kind of materials they made the wefts and the warps. There were really four types. So there were others, but these are the four main ones. The first one is Andras or Isho. And in Afghanistan, they often refer to them as Isho, but the common name is Andras. The second one is Shahi or Adam. The third one is Atlas or Khan Atlas. And the fourth one is Bahman or Ala Bahman. Before you forget all those names, I'll try to explain. So, Andras or Isho ikats. They were plain weave with silk warp, but the weft was cotton. This is a very important part of identifying Andras ikats. Because the weft was interlaced underneath the silk warps, the silk would get compressed, and you would get this ripped effect on the surface. So, whenever you see an ikat, it has that ripped effect. That means it's an old one. Silk cotton ikats were the older ikats. And the reason was quite simple, because they hadn't learned how to weave with silk warps. They could weave silk warps, silk on silk, but not ikats. It can't be quite more intricacy. So from the early 19th century, probably earlier, they were always silk cotton. And they made silk cotton once in about 1900s. And silk cotton is not one of the most collectible. At best, of course. The old examples of the warps were a little bit thicker because they hadn't refined how to make the warp threads thinner. And then the later ones were a little finer because they got better at it. And sometimes you could cheat because the idea is silk is about how shiny it is, right? It's about how it can jump at you. But the cotton weft would often take away the shine despite these beautiful colors. So what they did was they put egg white over it. They apply this egg white. And you sometimes see certain ikats, where there's egg white. People have all these mystical ideas, oh, egg white must have brought them good luck. No, it was just a cheat to make them look shiny. I mean, there's a lot of mythology that has been created by rug and textile dealers in Central Asia to those who went there back then to buy. So I'll try to mythologize a little. And this is some examples of Andras ikats. Look how fabulous. It's crazy, right? See, like, it's really just frightening. Catch your eyes, and it just really just boom. There's no subtlety there. These guys were not subtle with these designs. And of course, you see robes, you see panels, and bedspreads. And I couldn't fit more pictures in this little screen, so otherwise, they'd make a lot of things. Hats. And just one more thing. As I mentioned, that there are different centers of ikat, for example, Bukhara from Anna Valley, you can usually tell which ones are from where, if you've seen as many as I have. Usually the Fervana Valley ones have rustic blues, rustic greens, but the Bukhara ones are primary colors, or as close as primary colors so therefore they're more elaborate in design. Now, the second kind of detest is a shahir or an amri. Just imagine wearing that robe and the head on the side of the issue. They were also plain weave with silk warping, silk weft. So this is when they start learning how to use wefts. And weft is, for those who don't know, so the warps were like this, and the wefts went laced through it. A shahi, or amri cast, and please remember the word amri, and I'll come back to that. They were more shinier, they were more tighter. They started producing this around 1860s. And they produced it till about the first quarter of the 20th century, I would say. The problems with the shahi cast was this. Because there's no this concept of compression of warp over the cotton wefts, it was much tighter weave, and the wefts usually had a red color, and therefore sometimes the whites looked pinkish. And also because they were so tight and so fragile, they would rip quite easily if the tea and milk on it. Sometimes when you see antique ones, they often rip up. And sometimes indigo, like this piece, with those indigo colors, indigo often deteriorated the silk. But they were much lighter. At the time when they were made, everyone wanted a shahi cap because they were modern technology. But now, when we look at them ethnographically, brass ones are more important. And these are some examples of shahi. But again, I want to come back to this idea. Crazy designs, right? How on earth do we decipher these designs? What could they mean? Everything else is so structured, but the leaves are just boom, you know? How do you decipher the narrative? The third one was Atlas and Khan Atlas. Now, Atlas and Khan Atlas were really, it came about late 19th century, and this was the last Ikat form that died out. But about 1930s, and a lot of those really, I mean, if you see Central Asian Ikats that are coming new, I'm not talking about these beautiful new ones, but in the early 90s, they were these shiny over-the-top things. They were often at Khan Atlas, and Khan Atlas was either silk satin or pure satin. And this was just for economic reasons. They used satin because it was a cheap alternative to silk. And the designs of Khan Atlas Ikats were very vibrant. As you can see, I mean, I know the photos are nice photos, but the designs just generally, when you see them, they really jump. And there's a reason for it. You see, with other Ikats, so the walls would be put on the loom and the weft would be laced off every alternative. string. But with these ones, they did it off every 4, 5, 7. So on the back side, the design didn't show as much, but in the front, it really stood out. And here's some more examples of Khan's lens. Again, crazy designs, crazy ideas. Now, finally, the fourth one, the Bachmal, which is velvet. Or sometimes referred to Alo Bachmal. Alo meaning God, and Bachmal means silk velvet. And the idea is, if you do in Central Asia, it's godly. You know, it's so important. And this is probably one of the most complex Ikat forms, in my humble opinion, in the world. And by far one of the most expensive types. This particular one, I had to literally cut off my arm to pay for it. And what's unique about velvet Ikats is that they were not plain weave, they were slightly different. They had, let's see if I remember the technical answer. So what they had was that they used the two warp technique. So they had this undyed warps, silk warps, and then they had the resist-dyed silk warps. And the undyed silk warp will be woven with the weft acting as the, I guess, the foundation. And the resist dyed silk warp would be looped around this in a kind of a weird way. They would wound it and loop it. And in between that, they would put a wire. And after every so many centimeters, they would cut the wire out and it will open up. And it will give this impression of a pile. Well, the Ikats often have a pile, and this is how they create a pile. Now imagine, just to make this one little length that you see on, I mean, they used to, the looms were on this big, so they would, just imagine that would have taken it forever, and you had to be the best at what you did. So velvet Ikats were extremely expensive even back then, and only the super rich could afford it. They really only made it for about 40 years, from 1860s to 1910. And the tradition dyed was just way too expensive to make it. And sometimes they made these velvet ikats into these honor robes. It was a tradition in Central Asia generally. When people give gifts to dignitaries, they often make these honor robes. You know, it's always a particular robe. Even now they do it, but those robes don't look like this, unfortunately. And it's assumed that some velvet ikat tradition was possibly influenced by velvet ikat production that were referred to as mahmal, which is kind of the same one, in Yazd region of central Persia. And what this means is that in Yazd, they used to make velvet ikats, the one on the right, quite a lot in the early 19th century. And what I assume is that a lot of traders and merchants that would go to Persia, one of them got fled and brought this back. And they gave it probably permission in one of these workshops. And then they started trying to replicate this. But not only did they replicate it, they surpassed it in quality. But they incorporated their own designs, where you see the Persian one has floral designs, very Islamic Persian designs. They have their classic Arcadian designs. Okay. So that's the whole types of defects. Now this is one of the most interesting subjects, the designs of defects. The inspiration behind the rich designs of ikats. And there's a lot of books that have been written on ikats. Whenever it comes down to this, just everybody just kind of skipped through this. So I kind of, with a group of people who've been studying this for a long time, trying to really find a way to decipher these codes. Surely these wonderful, fantastic designs can't be all abandoned. They can't be coincidence. They can't just be there. Design as imagination. Well, one of the classic narratives that they say, well, how did these, what was the inspiration behind these crazy designs was, that they say, oil and water. So they have this kind of, people used to tell this in the 70s to those who discovered ikats, that the design maker would get intoxicated with hashish, opium. Okay, and this is quite interesting, okay? And then they would sit out under the moonlight, clear sky, or under the sunlight, and then they take oil and just drop it on water, and these crazy shapes will develop. So therefore, the designs of these beautiful things were really designed by art. I mean, it's beautiful, I love it, but I really think some textile dealer was trying to sell it to him. I think that's the truth. Because surely, the idea to assume the sophisticated design that was everywhere could be random. I just, unfortunately, I don't buy that. So there is, I think there is a language in there, a different language to decide. How do we do it? How do we do it? And I have to talk to a lot of people trying to attempt this. So please, ladies and gentlemen, humor me for a second. I'm going to show you a different way to look at these things. And please disagree with everything. It's just a perspective. And we might just somehow understand how to. So far, I've been reading them well, and I've built a good collection, so I'm on the right track. So, what are the symbols of ikats? Okay, before we get into that, let's use our imagination. Again, for the scientists, this is absolutely scientifically not accurate, so let's just try it. Let's imagine the earliest human beings. They wore clothes to keep warm. Whether they killed an animal and wrapped itself, hid themselves around with fur, or they had this very simple weaving. Wore these clothes, made these clothes garments. It was just to keep warm. It was not a fashion statement as we do now. As they got more sophisticated, they were living in harsh terrains, right? They were trying to survive. That's the fact. The early humans' end of it was to survive. And what did we need for survival? Fertility, prosperity, and protection. So when the first time they put flowers, the first human being that's assumed in Central Asia put a flower on their dress, it wasn't really to make it look pretty, kind of seduce a husband. No. It was just because flowers represent fertility. And this is a very important point about design generally. Of course, that mother will teach her daughter, that daughter will teach her granddaughter. Because with every generation, the flowers became extravagant and stylized. And the true meaning is lost. And what once was a motive has now become pattern. But I find any design anywhere is not random. Any design in anything is not random. They were probably an interpretation of a very early motive that over time has been lost, what it means. And I think this concept really works in Central Asia. And let's try it. I mean, so fertility, prosperity, and protection is the three things that mattered to Central Asian people for a very simple reason. They lived in deserts. Before these cities became big cities, they were in deserts. They were trying to survive the harshest terrain. They needed fertility for the family to have kids to survive. They needed prosperity to survive this harsh. They needed hope, and they needed protection. There was a lot of dangers. They could have just got stuck in a Gobi Desert. That's the end of that. You know, so you needed, they needed hope. And the foundation of Central Asian Incas, in my opinion, is these three ideas that they try to, all the designs really trying to kind of emote their motives from these three desires that they have. So motives that symbolize fertility is probably the easiest one that we can try to decide. But first, let's start like this. So let's look at these. The Incas designs are in the form of clouds. They kind of look like clouds, right? I mean, at the simplest form, as a form, they look like clouds. They're wavy, they're crazy designs. And in fact, I told you to remember the word Adam. Adam means cloud. And Incas often refer to as Adam. What's the relevance of clouds? Why did they take this form? No, it's not always, they didn't always do it, but generally, the earliest Incas had this cloud shape. And the idea is that the form of the design had to be clouds. Because clouds represented rain. For desert people, rain was very important. The foundation of the existence was rain. Clouds was a symbol of rain. Rain brought fertility. Fertility helped us survive. Then vegetation. Okay, and our road, which literally means pomegranate, not is the symbol of fertility in every culture you can imagine, from the Greeks to the Egyptians, and definitely to Central Asia. In fact, the pomegranate really kind of, from what I understand, came from Central Asia. So they often put these pomegranates. Okay, this one isn't, this is a slightly lost quarter of 19th century piece. So they don't have the clouds, they have the pomegranates. And in fact, sometimes in some parts of Central Asia, they give virgin brides pomegranates, like daughter, have this, they'll give you kids. It's always, it still echoes in the kind of belief system of Central Asian people. And again, all flora and vegetation imagery was symbols of fertility. Like you see there, it looks like flowers. On the bottom, you see beauté. In fact, we often refer to paisley as beauté, and that's a wrong mistake that someone made many hundreds of years ago, and now we often refer to paisley as beauté. Beauté actually literally means bud. And the beauté, what we call paisley or beauté, is actually bonongo, which means almond flower. And almond was, again, they used to give it to brides and give it kids. You know, this is the idea. So by putting these designs, knowingly or unknowingly, on their clothes, these ideas have been in their minds and generations that goes back thousands of years. And the flower, again, on the right is the same. Now we get into the more complicated ones. I hope I don't put you guys to sleep with this. So, motives that symbolize protection. Look at the sea cat. You know, the main motive is in the close-up. You see this little triangle of thing. And then these little castles and a little hook on top. This is what is called Muslim. Sea cats got designs for other genres, other kind of textiles, jewelry, and so on. This is another line you always hear, Ikat designs came from jewelry, from other. And a muska is really like this. They're little talismanic amulets. Can you see those silver ones? Those are actually Turkmen, but they had it all over Central Asia. They either had it like that, or the ones in the middle, which were silk embroidered ones. And inside these muskas, these triangular motifs, they were put scriptures, very sacred scriptures. And they would often put muskas on children's clothes because muskas represented, triangle amulets represented protection. Now why? That's not good enough, you know? Let's look at these muskas, the one on the left, and the one on the right, and the one in the middle. They're more five-sided. And let's look at the Hebrew. They look like yurts. Yurts were the tents, these circular tents. tents with dome heads, those are homes of tribals and Eurasian people. And if you look at it from a profile point of view, the Musta looks like a yurt. And it's a very simple idea that when they put this stuff on their clothes and the garments of their kids, these amulets, designs, they were saying, I hope the protection of the home goes with you wherever you go. And this is really the fundamentals of the Musta. And the Musta appears in every carpet. If you guys have got an ambient carpet, just look at it, you probably see muskets on the borders. They're not there by accident. The next motive is animal imagery, and this is really, really fascinating. The most obvious imagery that you often see in Central Asian designs, not just on ikats, but any kind of designs, the ram's horn. When you see, look at this, that's the red one. That's the ram's horn. The right one, ram's horn. They're drawn in different kind of interpretation. It always appears. Let me show you some more. Look, an embroidery, those curling things, that's the ram's horn. And a little muska, a very, very rare muska. You see the little ram's horn on top of the triangular heads. Or the other ones, you see these one side ram's horn, the other side, even on the sides of carpets, even on their tombstones or tomb wood, whatever's wood, but they have these ram's horns. Middle region, middle bottom, is very relevant. What is it about ram? What is so significant about ram? Why does it appear in Central Asian iconography from the beginning to now? Even the fact that these people are Muslims, it's still there to go. And there are really two interpretations of what the ram was. The ram was an animal, first it was a male, okay? Protector of his family, and it strengthens his horn. And you pick that strong point of that animal, and you put it on his arm in the hope that this would bring him protection. And they did it even on their father's grave, and their whole ancestors would protect them to survive this rough terrain. It goes back to this idea of desert, need this kind of protection. The other thing about ram was quite fascinating was that it's an animal that lived in a higher part of the land. The higher part of the mountain, the water is cleaner, the grass is greener, healthier. And the ram was an animal that was closer to the gods, and therefore had the protection of the gods. And therefore, if you put it around the Zion, that does. Again, this is not random. It's, I can show you 1,000 examples of ram's horn. Now, so the ram is a very important animal. This particular design I had seen for about 10 years. I know that sounds like not a lot of time for me. It was a long time to study this one design. It's too sophisticated for it to be random. It's just too interesting. I really thought, wow, what is this? And finally, someone really showed me a way to look at it. Again, following, if it's a protective symbol, what could it be? Well, the Sufi, the Darvish Sufis, these were the mystical Muslim people, the Darvish, the yogis of Central Asia, were basically, unlike the Muslim cultures that are developing now, they're very much about individualism. It's about progress. This is why Islamic societies were so progressive back then. And the mystical yogi often had a few things that was his possession. He had his little, what we call kashkol, I think, that he would go and he would ask, food. You would have no possession. It's about foregoing this earth and the possessions of this world and getting the divine connection. And then he had this, usually he had either an axe, not to kill people, but just symbolically. He had a stick sometimes, and he also had a pelt. A ram's pelt, often dyed red. And this is not, it goes back to probably the 13th century. And some say the pelt, this red pelt, was a foundation of the prayer rites that Muslims use. It's quite interesting. Now, if you go back to this design, that looks like a pelt, doesn't it? It's red. And it repeats too many times. So this is probably connected to the Sufi history. But then we can go even further back. In Tibet, they have a tradition in the old days, in the ancient times. The lamas would often sit on tiger skin. Real literal tiger skins stretched out was part of the ritual to do certain prayers. And later on, when they could have just gone and applied it, what they did is they started taking tigers and putting them, their skin stretched out as designs and garments. You see that quite a lot in Central in Tibet. And again, I always believe there's a connection between Sufism and Buddhism, because Afghanistan, Central Asia, generally was Buddhist before Southeast Asia. And certain ideas of Buddhism kind of connects with certain rituals of Sufism. So the point of this being is that these designs are so deep. It's not just Islam, it's so deep. And when they were putting it on, that I can assure you, probably half of them didn't know what it was. They just remember this design. It just passed on from generation to generation. And you see these designs in office as well, but in kneecaps, it can be more free flowing. Another design that is inspired from jewelry. And this particular thing, you see this on the left and on the right, this design repeats everywhere. And so many ikats, it repeats in carpets. What it really is what is known as an adamlic motif. And adamlics were these things that were a bit like earrings, but they're kind of big, they're like this big. And they were too heavy to hook it on the woman's ear, so what they would do is they would hook it on the sides of the hats. And adamlics would be worn, either first for a bride and then eventually just generally as some kind of an earring type of thing. And this design often appears in Central Asian ikats. More in ikats, but generally in a lot of other Islamic forms. These are some examples of adamlics, some of the collections. And I have probably got about 100 of them, so I've seen enough to see these patterns. Some of them were on the left side, you see some of them. They often came in twos, or two sides. They had a triangular sign, some of them were exaggerated, some of them curved at the bottom, some came in threes, and so on. And the middle one that you see is a very elaborate human one. It's very, very, very old. And sometimes they were so long. But the most important one here, the most telling one here, is the one on the right. Right? It's very interesting. Why would you make this? What is it about that shape? It's very fascinating. And humor me for a second. What does the adamant look like? If we stretch our imagination, the adamant looks like a figure, right? Maybe a figure. Like a woman. Like a mother. Or a goddess. I know it needs a lot of imagination. We don't need to get intoxicated with anything. But let's look at the next image. Okay? This is quite interesting. Adamant was a motif representing the mother goddess. This is a very deep subject and I'm not going to get into it. But if you see on the right, that's the Minoan snake goddess. Sometimes referred to the mother goddess and she tames snakes. The Greek god. And the adamlic has a connection. There's two guys, Balpinar and Kirsch did an extensive study of adamlic, especially in Anatolian kilims, but they covered the whole world, the whole other kind of genres as well. And the whole thing they wanted to do was say this mother goddess concept, here's art all over the world. I mean, for those of Christian in the world, Virgin Mary, mother goddess, repeats a lot. In a lot of theologies of religion. And also Hinduism, mother goddess is there. So what is mother goddess? Could it have come from Greek? Possibly Alexander the Great, conquered Central Asia, so why not? Or could it have come from Hindu culture? We would never know for sure because, again, Central Asia is a straight route. People are coming from everywhere. You're not going to keep a record of ideas where they're coming from. But it means that it's an ancient idea. And suddenly that crazy design that we see, suddenly we can connect it to something that's true. And the mother goddess, just to give you an idea, is a symbol of fertility. She held these two snakes. I know in this day and age we think of snakes as evil creatures, but back in the old days, the snake was considered as an animal that shed its skin and renewed itself. And by renewing itself, it revived itself. And it's a symbol of prosperity and fertility. On the subject of snakes, this is the last one. Yeah. And this is the last motif. Hopefully, you will just leave an idea. The S motif. The S motif repeats in every part that you could imagine, in every region, but very strongly in Central Asia. Look at this ikat. It's not necessarily the best ikat for my taste. It's a great piece. It's actually a nice shirt and trousers if you go on the steps. You see one of these. This particular ikat. And you know, the circle is clearly the sun. Fine. You know, okay. But what is that S? Okay? The S, to us, in our eyes in the 20th century, 21st century, is just a S. But at one point, it was a snake. And like I said at the beginning of this point, that motives, as they get interpreted, they lose their meaning. And if people forget how to get stylized, and eventually it becomes something that looks like a squiggly line. But nothing is random in any design. Just look at S's here. That's the jewelry, which is yes. It's not just in textiles, it's not just not in ikats. The more refined S's are, the more older the pieces. This is another trick to find age. Forget about patina and all this stuff. All that can be replicated, but the ornaments can never be replicated because people have lost their meaning. Now look at the right side. And this is an interesting one. This is a carpet made in Amudarya River, which is just in Central Asia. As a place, and these carpets often refer to as cloudbound carpets. So there's a place called Bashir. And sometimes they have these crazy kind of cloudbound designs that are considered S's or snakes. Okay? And the older ones look more like snakes. The younger ones just look like waves. Now, this particular one belongs to a friend of mine, and it's a very important one. It's a very early one. And the older ones show the design much better. Look at that snake. Interesting, isn't it? It has a little head on top of it. The other ones don't. Now look at the right side. It's a dragon, right? And this reflects a lot. Motives in Central Asia came because, again, it's a trade route. Ideas were coming from elsewhere. And this motif was absorbed from China, the dragon. Imagine the first silks that came. I mean, Central Asia wasn't always making silks. Apparently, the story, the myth is that this Chinese princess that was married off to Khotan king in the Xinjiang province, she hid some silk in her hair, and then she was the first who brought this Central Asia. But before that and prior to that, these silk fabrics were coming from China to Central Asia. They probably had dragons. And then they took the dragon, and they copied it because they wanted to be flashy. They can do it. And slowly, slowly over time, the dragon became a snake. And so on. I mean, it's, you can see the evolution of design. So, what this way of looking, this perspective that I thank you for humoring me, is that you can actually decipher any design if you really study all the other elements and just see the connections, because I don't even have to give you this talk. I can just show you these pictures. They speak for themselves. And it's very naive to assume this is coincidental, because I can show you a lot more pictures than this. What looked first is this crazy design of volume and blah, blah, we can see that there's a way we can decipher that. It takes a lot of study, a lot of time, but just we could pick few of them. And nothing in ikat design is irrelevant. It may be a bad interpretation of an ancient design, but not irrelevant. Please don't believe it. If it doesn't make sense, it's because the motive loss is clarity. So we understood that Central Asian designs are all about mode protection, prosperity, and fertility. But what is the narrative of ikat design? Persian Empire is often celebration of a king, in Western Empire celebration of religion, and in Central Asia, man's survival and conquest of the rough terrain, which just happened to be the heart of one of the most important traditions and history, and women's world. By surviving this land and conquering it, they became kings of the aesthetics. Thank you very much.
Presentation on a subject that you obviously grew up with.
Absolutely.
And it shows. And also, I would like very much to thank you Actually, Edric is the one who chased you, and we finally filled in the blank which we didn't have in our exhibition through that background that you